Hi everyone. Thank you very much for being here today. I'm very happy. It's my first time in Poland and I discovered this country. Very happy to be here. And today I would like to talk to you about costs because money is very important in the cloud, especially in the cloud because money scared everybody in the cloud. And to do that, I will share with you my experience in Google Cloud. I'm Guillaume Blaquer, I'm Google Developer Expert on the cloud, and I know very well this platform, but what I will say is applicable on any cloud provider, in fact, because the principles are the same. I'm also a data architect at Carrefour. I'm based in France. I'm data architect at the headquarters of Carrefour, not at Carrefour Poland, but yes, I saw that there is some store also in Poland for Carrefour. Just before starting, remember you have Slido to ask your questions. You have here the pass and the room number to pick, and I will answer your questions at the end of the session. Just the timer didn't start. Yeah, perfect. So now, before going to detail how to reduce the cost, I would like to ask you a question. What does cost in the cloud? What is cost? What are the services, the things that cost in the cloud? To answer these questions, we have to think what's a data center on-prem, in the cloud, on Google Cloud, on Azure, on AWS. What's the pillar of any data center? Or what's the pillar of your computer, because it's exactly the same thing. In fact, you have three pillars, and the first one is the processing. You need processing units to perform things. CPUs, memory, GPUs, you need to process something. And what you are processing some data, and you need to store the data. The second item that you need is the storage. And because you have a lot of VMs, your services are exposed to the internet, you need network to plug your VMs and to connect your machine. That's the three pillars of any cloud provider, any on-prem environments. And you need that for doing computing. Your computer is the same thing. You have a CPU, you have a disk, and you have a Wi-Fi card to communicate with outside. And of course, what will cost in the cloud? The same thing. In fact, we pay for the CPU, we will pay for the storage, and we will pay for the network. Exactly the same thing, the same item, because you need them and you need to pay for them. And that's the basics. Any cloud provider, any environment needs those atomic elements. And then the cloud provider build services on top of those elements. And you have a pricing model for each services. You have the compute, the VMs, the compute engine, what you need. You need CPUs, you need disk, and we pay for that for the duration that you use those elements. That's the basics. When you need more, you can use serverless products. Just before me, there is a presentation of AWS Lambda. It's exactly the same thing. You have instances. You will pay for the instance resources, the size of the instance, the CPU, the memory of the instance, the number of instances that you have, and the duration of your processing on those instances. When you talk about clusters, could be Dataproc, it's Hadoop cluster on Google Cloud, Dataflow, or Kubernetes, DKE on Google Cloud. The same thing, you have VMs, it's your node in your cluster, you have VMs, node, VMs, CPU memory, and storage, disk, and you have a duration of your cluster, of your node, of your instance on your cluster. We can talk about also the storage. You have database, you have to pay for the storage. Here is a cloud storage. You pay for the storage. For the logs, you also pay for the storage of the logs. You also pay for the processing. You have to ingest the logs, and you pay also for computing, for CPU and memory to process your logs and to store the logs in the logs bucket on cloud logging. For BigQuery, a data warehouse on Google Cloud, it's the same thing. You have to pay for the data that you store on BigQuery. You pay also for the data that you process. It's a serverless product. You pay only when you perform a request on your database, a query in your database. You pay for the volume of data that you process. And because you process your data, you need CPU and memory to process the data of your query. I can continue with other type of services, more based on the message or based on the request that you perform, like PubSub. PubSub, it's a message queue services. You have a publisher, a subscriber, and you have a message in it. You pay for the size of the message, and to forward the message from the subscriber, from the publisher to the subscriber, and you have to pay for this processing. Same thing for Firestore. Firestore, it's a document database, and you pay only the request that you do. That means if you don't use Firestore, you pay nothing. If you use it a lot, you will pay a lot. Why? Because when you perform a query, you need to have CPU and memory to perform this query, and you pay per query. That's the basics. And why everybody is scared about the cloud is because you pay that even if you misuse the cloud. If you perform a mistake, if you create a cluster too big, instead of creating a cluster of 10 VMs, you add 10 more and you create a cluster of 100 VMs, yeah, it's not the problem of the cloud provider. It's your problem, and you have to pay for that because you use those resources. And that's why it's a problem, the cost in the cloud, and many have fears to go to the cloud because of that. And here my talk is to help you to limit the risk and to manage proactively those issues. Here in this description, you have CPUs, you have memories, you have storage, you have nothing for the network. Why I don't add the network in this kind of services? Because as I said before, you have three things that cost in the cloud: the CPU, the storage, and the network. Here, there are no network, because from my experience, it's only an empirical rule, and it's not really true, but it's what I observed in several projects, is when you pay $1 for the network, you will pay 10 for the storage, and you will pay 100 for the processing. That's why if you have to focus on something, focus on the processing. Maybe you can duplicate data on storage to have a more efficient processing and to reduce the processing time by duplicating the data on the storage. But at the end, the network, yes, it costs, but it's very low. Of course, if you have an application like Netflix or YouTube, your network will be overused, and of course, the ratio won't be the same. But in general, for standard, usual cloud applications, it's the case. So first, focus on the CPU's optimization, then the storage, and the network, don't care. So now, going deeper in Google Cloud and how to effectively be proactive and be reactive about the cost. And the first recommendation, anytime, is to set alerts. Alerts on a budget, alerts on a billing account, alerts on a project. If you want, you can also set alerts on resources, if you want. No problem for that, but set an alert to know what's happened and to understand how your billing, what's the behavior of your billing. You can also choose the observation period, could be monthly by default, I use that. You can also have a custom observation period. Maybe your weekdays and your weekend are a different behavior, and you want to have a very precise alerts on each part of the week, maybe. And you can also choose a notification channel to receive this alerts. Could be an email, just to be informed. It could be a message in PubSub, because you want to plug a custom code to make something. I will go back on this pattern at the end of the presentation. You can publish a message on Slack channel to inform a team, something like that. Keep in mind that alerts, it's only alerts. You reach a threshold, you send a message, you send an alert. No more. And it could be a problem. So that's it. Reactive. You observe your budget, your billing, and when you reach the threshold, you send an alert. But sometimes it's too late. To be proactive, you can limit the products, the services available for your users. You can use IAM, it's Identity and Access Management, to authorize or to deny the access to some products. And it's great because if in your company you don't use Hadoop ecosystem on Google Cloud is named Dataproc. You say we don't use Dataproc. We don't allow to use it in my company because no reason to me to use it. That's true. But if a day you are a new talent, a new employee that is very good. In Hadoop and he know how to optimize the process, he won't be able to use it, he will be frustrated, he will have to learn something else, or maybe he will have to deploy Hadoop environments on VMs and not use Dataproc because he can't. And for me, you use the freedom of the users and the power of the cloud is to try, is to fail fast and to iterate, to try something else. And if you don't have this freedom to try what you want because you have to request the permission and you have to wait 3 days to have the approbation of the permission and so on, it's too slow and your users are frustrated. What I prefer to limit the usage. In fact, you can use the product that you want, but when you use a product, you limit the amount of what you can do on that. It's great because, for example, in BigQuery, you have no limits, and BigQuery, you pay the volume of data that you query, and because it's very easy and it's very fast to query petabyte of data, it can cost a lot at the end of the day. I already saw a billing of $50,000 at the end of the day, only for BigQuery, because someone only click and performs many queries during the day, so it can be very expensive. You can add quotas to say, I would like to limit to 1 terabyte of data query every day per user. Okay, you can do that, it's perfect, because you can use all the products, but with a limited amount of what you can do. The problem with that is when you have a large company with hundreds, thousands of projects, you need to maybe to change the limits because you want to change the sandbox limits of all your developers. You have 1,000 developers and you have to update 1,000 projects. Okay, you can automate that with scripts, with Terraform, with what you want, but it takes time. You can have issues with rate limits on some APIs of Google Cloud to update the quotas. So it's not easy to manage, but it's better than the previous solution. You have to try both and to find your best way, the way that fits your organization, fits your needs in your company. Another thing, and for me, the power of the cloud is to share the resources. What I mean by sharing the resources, when you have your data center, it's your data center, and you don't share your VM with anybody. It's only for you, and you don't share it. With cloud, it's different. You don't have your VMs. You only rent the VMs. And when you don't need it, you release the VM, and other customers can use the CPU, the memory, the disk. And you have to do that to reduce the cost, because if you rent shorter the VM, you will pay less because you reserve a smaller amount of time your resources. For that, you can use the resource only when you need them, You can start them, stop them automatically, or you create or delete them automatically. You can scale up and down your clusters, or it could be done automatically if you want, but the scalability, it's very important to, according to a metrics, to scale up or down, and not to have servers with 10 VMs, and maybe a day we'll need 10 VM, but during the night, we don't need so much VMs. You can also use serverless products. Why? Because serverless products, by definition and by design, they scale very fast. They scale up and then scale down very fast, and you pay only when you use the resources, when the serverless product process your request. You pay only when you use them, and it scales to zero. That means if you don't use the service, you don't pay it. App Engine, Cloud Run, Cloud Function, Firestore, Datastore. If you don't use it, you don't pay for it. So it's perfect. Last things, serverless products are by default replicated over a region. On Google Cloud, you have one region with three zones. And by default, when you have a serverless product, it's replicated on all the zones of a region. And by default, it's high available on that region. If you use VMs for the same thing, on one zone, you need at least three VMs. And because you have three zones, you need to have 9 VMs at the end to have the same level of availability. And using serverless product instead of 9 VMs, you will see the cost difference is huge. And how I can scale up and down or start or stop my VM automatically? You have scheduling feature on Google Cloud. You can use Cloud Scheduler to call APIs. You can call the API of Compute Engine to start your VM, to stop your VM, to create a VM. It's a direct call to the API. It works very well. You can also have a feature named Schedule MIG. MIG is for Manage Instance Group. It's a group of VM that you can scale up and down. And on a schedule, you can say, during the night, I want one VM. At 9 a.m., I want four VM because I know that the customer start to connect to my application and I have to have a bigger cluster. It's not automatic, but you can manage manually the scale up and the scale down of your resources. And you can also use an orchestrator. On Google Cloud, it's named Cloud Workflow. What's an orchestrator? It sequence some actions. For example, you can schedule the start of the workflow start VM, run a job, I don't know, for example, a training of a model, of machine learning models. And at the end, the workflow say, OK, the training is finished. I will delete the VM. And like that, you have a sequence, and you don't lose time to say, I start at 9 a.m. and stop at 10 p.m. the VM. When the job is over, the VM is stopped or deleted, and you don't pay for nothing. We can continue with another interesting feature on Google Cloud. It's named Recommender. Recommender is a powerful tool that use AI to understand your project, and according to the other project on Google Cloud, the model can perform recommendation to save money. For example, to say, hey, your VM is underutilized, you can reduce the number of CPUs, the size of the memory, maybe the size of the disk. No, you can reduce the size of the disk, but you can delete some local SSD, and you can save money at the end of the month. You can also know what's your unused IP addresses, because when you reserved an IP, if you don't use it, you pay it on Google Cloud. If you plug your VM on a VM, for example, you don't pay the IP address. But all the unused are paid. It's very low, but you pay for nothing. Same thing for the persistence disk. Persistence disk, you store your data on it. You can keep the data. When you pay for your disk, you keep your data. But if this disk is never attached to a VM, why you keep it? You can extract the data, store the data elsewhere in a cheaper storage, like on cloud storage, for example, and delete the disk. And when you need it again, create a disk, upload the data, and that's all. So you have a lot of recommendations like that. I can continue with the committed use discounts. The AI can observe your project and say, oh, OK, you use those VM, 10 VM per month full time. OK, I can recommend you to commit for 1 year or 3 years, 10 VM. Like that, you can save 50% of the cost over 3 years, stuff like that. Finally, on BigQuery, you have to pay for the data that you process. And if you don't want, you can reserve slots. What a slot? It's a slice of CPU and memory. And if you reserve slots, you don't pay on demand. You pay for the reservation that you do, that you did. And recommendation can say you can reserve 500 slots during the night to perform your query. And if you follow this recommendation, you can save some percentage of money. Talking about discounts, because it's very interesting, you have built-in discount. Something you have nothing to do is named sustained use discount. What is it? You start a VM. If a VM runs 1 month, you have 30% of discount automatically. Nothing to do. If you run only 20 days, I think you have only 10%. And if the VM runs less than 15 days in the month, you have no discounts. So you have to think, I have to stop and start my VM, or can I let my VM running and benefit of the sustained use discount? You can have both to evaluate. But for that, nothing to do, it's automatic. You have also, and I just said that before, the committed use discount. If you commit resources, CPU, memory, GPU, local SSD, for 1 year or 3 years, you can have up to 56% of discount on the cost. It's also the same thing with Cloud Run. You can also have the committed use discount on Cloud Run. If you say, I will use my Cloud Run instances, one Cloud Run instances every time, you can commit on it and pay less on Cloud Run. You can use preemptible or spot. Spot is very known on AWS, but now it's the same thing on Google Cloud. It's cheaper VM that you can reserve, but Google is able to preempt the VM if Google needs them, or if another customer needs them, and to pay the full price of the VM. But for non-critical workload, you can use preemptible or spot instances that can save you a lot of money if you can stop your process anytime and to start again with another preemptible instances, and you are not time constrained and so on. You can save a lot. For example, on GKE cluster, you can have a node pool of standard VM and a node pool of preemptible VM, and you can run your non-critical workload on the preemptible pool. And because you have Kubernetes that can restart automatically your VM, no worry, it's only your process that can be resilient to any interruption. BigQuery slot, I also said that just before, to save money and to have a flat rate. Sometimes when you talk with your CFO in your company, you say to the CFO, yeah, maybe 1 month I will pay 1,000 euro, and the next month I will pay 10,000 euro. And you have a billing with spike, and the CFO don't like that. They want a predictable budget over the year. Slots can be the solution. You can say, OK, I will pay 10,000 euros all over the year. Okay, it's not efficient in terms of pricing and cost, but your CFO will be happy because the financial team don't like unpredictable cost and budget. Another thing is cloud storage classes. You have 4 storage classes, and from the hottest to the coolest. And in fact, the standard storage is the most expensive, but you pay nothing to read the data. And if you are more and more colder, you will pay less for the storage, but you will pay more for the reading. Be careful, because for some storage classes, you need to let your file at least 1 month, 3 months, or 1 year. If you delete your file before, we'll pay a fee for early deletion. So read carefully the documentation to let your files the minimal duration according with your use case. And finally, you can use free tiers. It's per billing account, and you can use more than 20 products for free. BigQuery, Cloud Storage, Cloud Run, Cloud Function, App Engine, a lot of serverless products. You have also DataStore, FileStore, PubSub. So a lot of products that you can use for free per billing account. And for your personal account, it's perfect. Personally, I perform my test with that, and I pay nothing because I can perform small tests easily with that. You have also features to limit something. You have the quotas to limit the resources globally, but you have also limits that you can put on your different services. With managed instance group, you can say you can scale up automatically on a matrix, but you have a limit and you can go above a max instance definition. Same thing for Dataflow. You have workers. In fact, Dataflow creates a cluster of VMs on your project, but you want not more than 50 workers. You can put a max limit on that. Same thing for Dataproc. This time, it's Hadoop cluster. It's not a Dataflow cluster, but the same principle. On GKE Kubernetes, you can say the same thing. On a node pool, I want maximum max number of nodes per node pool. And you can also use serverless my product. And you have the max instance parameter. You can say, I don't want more than 100 instances. It's by default, Cloud Run, it's 100 instances by default. You can increase or decrease this max instance parameter. Yeah, because if you have some attacks, some issues on your design, the scalability, the automatic scalability of the products, Madison Group, Dataflow, Dataproc, serverless product, can scale automatically and almost not, it's not infinite, but it can be very high and very fast. So the max instance and the max limit. No, the limits will be save you a lot of issues, especially if, for example, you have an alert during the night or the weekend. It can take time to react to this alert, and this feature can save you during the night or the weekend. Finally, you have also custom code, because sometimes all the feature doesn't exist on Google Cloud. And custom code, you can call something, especially on the alerts. On the alerts on budget, why? Because sometimes, for example, with BigQuery, it takes time to, how can I say that? When you consume data on BigQuery, you will pay for this data, but the cost can take time to be taken into account, and so your alerts can take time to see your budget, and okay, your budget is above a threshold. With BigQuery, for example, it can take up to 12 hours to have the billing information take into account, and so your alerts can take up to 12 hours to be triggered. And come is in because it's very easy and very fast to consume and to pay a lot with BigQuery, alerts is not enough. That's why we built in my previous company a query. In fact, we use the logs, we query the logs every 10 minutes to see the BigQuery utilization, the number of bytes built of each query, and we perform a sum every 10 minutes, and we react on this solution. Maybe we send an email, maybe we ban a user that use too much resources. So we can do that. Other problem is the alerts. Why? Because the alerts, it's only alerts. It doesn't block nothing, it's only an alert. And if you do nothing, you will continue to pay, and even if you are over quota, over budget, you will continue to pay. That's why when you have an alert, you can have a notification channel named PubSub. You can publish this alert on PubSub, catch the message on PubSub. PubSub is a publisher subscriber, so you have a subscriber that listens this PubSub topic to catch the alert information, and you can remove the billing account on a project. So if you do that, we stop immediately the project, because no billing account will stop the project and no resources will be used on the project. It could be dramatic for your business because the project is stopped, but it will save your money because you stop to consume and to continue to pay the over budget of your project. It's very interesting also the night and the weekend, because if you don't have that, you have an alert on the Friday evening, and you can see the alert only in Monday morning, 2 days of over quota, over budget issues on your billing. Could be a nightmare. Last things, maybe you don't have all the metrics that you need on Google Cloud. You can also, in your code, add your custom metrics and also have dashboards and alerts on those custom metrics if you want. A final thing, maybe the most important and the most suitable for the future is to upskill your organization. What I mean, you can train your users, your employees, to use better your platform, Google Cloud, of course, but also Azure, AWS, maybe your on-prem environments, and to be smarter and to think better. When I'm doing that, I use those resources. Should I use it or not? I have another solution. Can I do that differently? Can I optimize my code, my pattern, my application? Can I architect it differently? So, if you train your users, it's better for you. You can also empower the users, your employees, in their spend on a project. Okay, if you spend the money of the company, the company has less profit. If the company has less profit, you have less salary increase, less resources in your team, less advantages. I don't know, but yeah, you. Employees are part of the company, and also the employees need to be aware of the money of the company and the spend of the company. You take care of your money, you can take care of the money of the company also. And if you don't find something normal for you, I think you can find something not normal also for the company. But not everybody has the same mindset, that's why it's important to to do the job with your team. You can also rank the projects and to have a competition, a challenge between all the teams about the consumption on money, maybe the consumption of CO2, of carbon, because now on Google Cloud, you have also a dashboard for the carbon consumption of a project. And maybe you want to reduce either the cost, either the CO2, maybe both. But it could be great to rank the project like that and to follow the ranking month after month, week after week. And like that, you can change your team and maybe create a competition and to reward the team that performs the best, the effort to reduce the cost to reduce the CO2 and maybe to communicate internally or externally on the best practices taken by the team to reduce their cost or the CO2. It could be interesting and challenging for the users to do that. Of course, the user also, the developers need to have time to do that, to think that, and to maybe to re-architect the application, and maybe it's not aligned with the requirement of a product manager and the roadmap of the product. Finally, and I think it's also the future, you can make your project greener. What I mean here is because you use CPUs, memory, disk, and so on, in fact, you use energy, and the energy can generate carbon and emission. If you use less CPUs, we use less energy, and of course, we'll reduce the cost, but also the carbon footprints. Both are very correlated, and it's another way to empower and to challenge the team. Maybe I think the younger developer, okay, you can save money, but you can also save the planet. And it's also a good challenge, and I think a challenge for the future. Maybe use another language of development, something more efficient and something like that, but you have a mindset to create around that. And that's all for me. I will go to the question. To go here. Okay, the first one, limit data proc, is it, you can see my screen, yes. Is it only amount of VM can be regarding the size of the VM? Yeah, in fact, in data proc, you can't change the size of the VM. You have a cluster of homogeneous VMs. You can add or remove VM in your cluster, but you can't change the size of the cluster. If you want to change the size, you need to create another cluster and to stop the previous one. Something great, your cluster can be ephemeral. You can create a cluster for 1 hour, run your job and stop it. If the cluster is too big, next time, create a smaller cluster or a bigger. You can do that easily. It's amount of PPU more smaller, less higher. I think the second part of the question is: should I use a bigger VM, but few VM of big yeah. A few number of VM, but avec, with big VMs, or small VM, but a lot of small VM on my cluster. I can't answer this question because it depends a lot of your use case. Personally, I prefer to use small VMs and to add only a small amount of resources when I need it, because I don't have a big step in the billing and the resources that I use. So small steps are better. But sometimes small steps is not enough because it don't grow so fast, and you need to grow faster when you have a website. It's a Black Friday, you need to scale up very fast. And for that, you need to add big VM in your cluster. And for me, it depends especially of your use case. In one slide, AI used for control the cost and manage the AI service. The AI, in fact, the AI services, I think it's the recommender. The recommendation is free. Google observe your project and perform recommendation for free. If it's free for you, you have nothing to pay. It's included in the package. So for that, it's free. What's the detail in what in what detail can we can user developer see info how much does that feature we just added cost? not CPU price in GCP, but per feature in your app. It's very, very difficult to answer the question how to do that personally when we have the cost of my application. I can see the cost in the past, and sometimes I can see a peak, the cost reach a new plateau, in fact, and I ask what's happened, and this feature has been released. Okay, I know when I observe the impact of the feature in my budget, I know how much cost the new feature, but in advance, I can't say the feature. I can know the number of VMs, indeed, the number of VMs, the number of CPUs, the number of things like that, but the feature is only a piece of software deployed in the cloud. How will cost this piece of software is very hard to know. And even if you perform benchmark on your computer is not the CPU that you will find in the cloud, and you can't estimate, you can't correlate your CPU consumption on your computer and the CPU consumption in the cloud. It's very different, and for me it's impossible. You have to test to understand. Maybe to test in acceptance environment, maybe to don't test in production, but without any test, you can't know that. Any suggestion how to protect on personal and private test GCP account? Why I don't want to pay more than 100 euros a month ever. How to protect? Alerts, you can put an alert on a budget, but as I said, it's only an alert. And what we did at Veolia, my previous company, we have an alert when you reach the 100% of the budget, your 100 per month, you publish a message in PubSub, and in PubSub, you catch the message in PubSub, and you remove the billing account on the project. You can also send an email to the user to explain why the billing account has been removed, but except this solution, we didn't find any way to stop differently the consumption on a project. Take the billing account, remove it, you stop to pay, and you stop the project also. For developer, it's not a problem, because developer must be cautious of their cost. In production, it's more problematic, but sometimes it's a requirement. I have friends that work at L'Oréal, and during a weekend, he saved 80,000 euros because he had a loop on Cloud Run, and he had tons of instances on Cloud Run. And thanks to this feature to unplug the billing account on the project, he saved about 80,000 euros in one weekend. You can save a lot if you implement this feature. But the problem, you have to implement it. Google don't provide feature or easy things to unplug the billing account on a project. It's an API call, but you have to implement it by yourselves. So, and the last one, what GCP did for protect the nature? Oh, it's a good question. It's a little bit out of topic because I'm not expert on that. I know that Google do a lot. Google plan to be carbon to use zero carbon. Yes, carbon. Today, Google Cloud is carbon neutral. In 2030, Google plan to be carbon zero emission. I think you will use your data center with no carbon energy all the day long and all the years long. But what they do more, I don't know. They bought a lot of solar energy and renewable energy. What they are doing? Their data centers are more optimized than the others in terms of cooling, in terms of water use, and so on. But I'm not expert on that. I know they do a lot, but I'm sure you will find more details on the internet or on Google Cloud website. And I'm not sure if my explanation will be good or not. Yeah. OK. Thank you very much. It will be a pleasure to be with you today. If you want to reach me, I have my Twitter here. I will share my slides on Twitter if you want. You can reach me on LinkedIn, Medium, and so on. Don't hesitate. It's always a pleasure for me to share with you. And if you have another question in the lobby, I will be here. And that's all. Thank you very much.